Hi, I'm Andrew Drane from Harcourt Sewers Living and welcome to the September Real Estate Market Wrap-Up. September marked a striking turn in housing market sentiment. Consumer confidence increased, new listings rose, and six of the eight capital cities recorded a rise in home values over the month. However, falling values in Melbourne and Sydney, which make up approximately 40% of Australia's housing stock by number, 55% by value, pushed the national reading into a fifth straight month of decline. The rate of decline across Sydney's market has been consistently easing since July, however, and the remaining capital cities have all returned to some level of growth. Regional markets have continued to outperform relative to capital cities. At a broader level, the combined regional index has slipped only by 0.08% since March, while the capital city values have fallen by 2.6% over the same period. The housing market outlook is subject to headwinds as fiscal support is reduced, labour markets remain weak, and mortgage payment deferrals become less common. However, there are a number of factors that are supporting improved housing market conditions. The aggregate effect of low mortgage rates and the prospect that rates could fall even further, low inventory levels, government incentives, and improving consumer sentiment seem to be outweighing the negative economic shock brought about by the pandemic. Low advertised stock levels are a key factor supporting housing values. Nationally, new listing numbers remain 22% lower than a year ago and 25% below the five-year average. That's a big decrease. Similarly, the total advertised stock levels were 14% below last year's level and 17% below the five-year average. Such tight inventory levels at a time when demand is recovering is creating some urgency in our markets. While the number of advertised homes is 14% lower than a year ago, our estimate of home sales through the September quarter was 2.8% higher than the same time last year. The imbalance between available supply and housing demand is one of the reasons why housing values have hardly stalled through the COVID period so far, and helped to explain the recent upward trend in values across some cities. We aren't seeing either any sign of a rise in distressed listings or stock starting to pile up in the market. In fact, the opposite seems to be true, where new listings are being absorbed in the market faster than the rate in which they are being added. This is simply a supply and demand issue. This trend will be important to monitor over the coming months, and fiscal support tapers and the financial situation of borrowers taking a repayment holiday is assessed by their lender. A rise in urgent or distressed listings will provide further test for the resilience of the housing values. Auction markets have also shown some strength, with the capital city clearance rate holding around the 60% range through September, relative to the decade average of about 64%. So it's not bad at all. In Sydney, housing values across the lower quartile were down only 0.4% over the September quarter, while upper quartile values fell by 2.1%. In summary, apart from Melbourne, the performance of the housing market is consistently improving. Most of the capitals and regional areas of Australia are recording rising home values, or in Sydney's case, a reduced rate of decline. The improved performance comes only after mild value falls, with capital cities' home values down only 2.6% since March. To date, the support of low interest rates, scarce inventory, fiscal policy initiatives, and government incentives, together with relatively successful virus containment, have insulated the housing market from larger falls in value and activity. Unsurprisingly, the markets where the virus has been well contained and economic activity is less restricted are faring the best. Looking forward, the market will be contending with a mixture of head and tailwinds. Headwinds will be evidenced as fiscal support winds down and distressed borrowers come to terms with their repayment commitments. It is logical to assume there will be a rise in urgent or distressed listings over the coming months. However, so far, we have seen new listings rapidly absorbed by the demand in the market. The expectation for persistently weak labour market conditions, low rates of overseas migration, and minimal wage growth are factors adding to the downside risk. As businesses have become more embracing of technology and less labour-intensive practices, lingering unemployment could constrain housing demand. On the upside, however, we are expecting a new round of government spending initiatives and stimulus measures to be announced in tonight's budget. These policies are likely to be aimed at supporting jobs growth and consumption, incentivising business investment and productivity improvements. Some potential initiatives may include a substantial lift in infrastructure spending, bringing forward income tax cuts, extending incentives for residential construction, and more funding for social and community housing. Additionally, the Treasurer recently announced a plan to relax lending laws. If enacted, we could see credit flows become more streamlined and available by March next year. Credit availability has historically shown a close relationship with activity in the housing sector, and that's very important. The prospect of lower interest rates later this year also presents some upside to the housing market conditions. Well, that's our September market wrap-up. I'd say pretty good news generally for the market moving forward. I'm Andrew Drane from Harcourt Tools Living. I'll see you in the October market wrap-up.